Hello students, looking at current affairs for 8th April, the news items picked up from the Hindu newspaper are these 11. We'll look at them in detail. The first one, government mulls lockdown extension amid request from states. So lockdown, which has been in effect from 25th March and is due to end on 14th April, may be extended. Union government has indicated that because many states have openly appealed for its continuation as the number of COVID-19 cases continue to rise. So, number of COVID-19 affected districts also increased from 62 on March 20 to 284 on April 6, and 30 states and union territories are affected. So, GOM has also been formed, a group of ministers on COVID-19. So, a meeting took place chaired by Defence Minister Rajnath Singh, and it has been recommended that the closure of all educational institutions and restrictions on all religious activities having public participation should be extended till 15th May. So these are the statements given by various state chief ministers on extension of the lockdown. The next is, India lifts ban on export of hydroxychloroquine. So India has announced that it has rescinded its earlier ban on the export of malaria drug hydroxychloroquine. So it is now been used in countries such as US as a possible line of treatment for COVID-19. So this is because the drug's efficacy has not yet been clinically proven. So government had actually placed on March 25 itself had placed restrictions on hydroxychloroquine import. So a blanket ban further was there on any kind of export of the drug. And this decision was taken on April 4, 2020. We had seen it in news that the blanket ban had been imposed by Director General of Foreign Trade, DGFT. But now on April 6, the ban has been overturned as such. So Ministry of External Affairs announced the overturning of the ban, and this came hours after US President Donald Trump said that India could invite retaliation if it withheld supplies of hydroxychloroquine, for which US, Brazil and other countries have already placed advance orders. So opposition also slammed the government's decision, saying that the Indians, as such, Indians have the first right over this life-saving medicine during coronavirus pandemic. ICMR, Indian Council of Medical Research, has also cleared hydroxychloroquine to be used as a prophylaxis, that is, as a preventive medication by doctors, nurses and other health staff. So here is the detail of what we just discussed, the gist of it. So you can see antimalarial drug hydroxychloroquine is an interferon blocker. So it works by diminishing the immune system's response to the viral infection. So it's a hyperactive response by the immune system is said to be primarily responsible for pneumonia, also fallout of the severe COVID-19 infection. So a study in France has shown that hydroxychloroquine alone or in combination with azithromycin appeared to reduce virus levels quicker, prompting drug regulators in several countries, including India, to approve the drug in restricted settings. But several scientists say that there are faults in the design of these trials which have approved it. Also, dosage is also linked to instances of cardiac arrhythmia and liver damage. So these aspects also have to be taken into consideration. Wide usage may actually handicap people's ability to fight the infection. Also, Indian drug manufacturers say that they have sufficient stockpiles and enough to export, but there are reports that the stocks are running out and rheumatoid arthritis patients find them unavailable in stores. So here you can see the export history of the drug can be shown over the years. From 2017-18 to 2018-19, there was a 46% increase in export. And this is the April to Feb period of 2018-19 to 2019-20, there was a reduction in export. So India's installed capacity of hydroxychloroquine active pharmaceutical ingredient is 40 tons. Means 200 million tablets a year. So export is worth $19 billion in hydroxychloroquine. And the domestic consumption of these 200 million tablets is 24 million tablets. But then this is in general times. Presently it has been used majorly to fight COVID-19. Then next is Kerala-Karnataka border row sorted out. center informed Supreme Court. So we had seen this case going to Supreme Court. A ruling had been given by Kerala High Court on April 1, 2020, and this was on blockade on Kerala-Karnataka border. Karnataka had sealed its border, saying that Kerala is the worst affected state in the country with respect to COVID-19, and Kasaragod district, which adjoins Karnataka as such, is the worst affected district of Kerala with over 100 positive cases of COVID-19. So that's why it had blocked its border. But Kerala urged that for essentials and to allow patients requiring urgent medical treatment, they should have access to hospitals in Mengaluru, which is closest to them, and that's generally has been used. So Karnataka refused to revoke the restrictions on border. Kerala High Court ordered that the restrictions should be removed, remote road blockade should be ended. But Karnataka approached Supreme Court, appealing Kerala High Court order with special leave petition. So Supreme Court asked them to look into the matter, and now while Supreme Court is also going to hear the case, but the central government has now informed Supreme Court that the border row has been sorted. So you can see Karnataka as such will now allow patients requiring urgent medical treatment to cross the border and access hospitals in Mangaluru in Karnataka. Then next is Supreme Court seeks reply on plea to evacuate Indian students. So petition has been filed in the Supreme Court seeking urgent evacuation of hundreds of Indian students who have been stranded in UK due to the lockdown and disruption following the COVID-19 pandemic. So the petition says countries with far greater incidence of mortality like China, Spain, Italy, Iran, South Korea, and even US have not imposed any embargo on the return of their own nationals from foreign shores, while India has. So petition has been filed and Supreme Court has sought government response. Then next is 3 Manipal students win MIT's COVID-19 hackathon. So MIT, Massachusetts Institute of Technology in US, had this COVID-19 challenge event, and there were 10 tracks on which winners were announced. So the winner of their track were 3 students of Manipal Institute of Technology, who had this who to test and win track, in which they won. So the work they had done is they had narrowed down the problem of overcrowded hospitals with inappropriate admissions. Their hospitals are overcrowded because of inappropriate admissions. Less than 5% of the population under 50 needs hospitalization, they say. So their solution was to build a telehealth platform for non-contact monitoring of vital signs such as heart rate, respiratory rate, and blood oxygen concentration using a phone camera or webcam at home. So this would prevent transfer of COVID-19 to healthcare professionals. Then next is, gender violence is a shadow pandemic, United Nations. So UN Women has urged member states to include prevention of violence against women in the action plans on COVID-19 and consider setting up shelters and helplines as such as essential services. So gender-based violence is now called a shadow pandemic. According to UN Women, the recent data shows violence against women and girls, particularly domestic violence, has intensified during the lockdown period. France has seen 30% increase in domestic violence since the lockdown. Even Argentina, Singapore, Canada, Germany, UK, US have registered increase in cases of domestic violence and demand for emergency shelters. Also earlier, UN Chief Antonio Guterres had also appealed for ceasefire on domestic violence after the horrifying global surge in domestic violence cases. Then next is, Mehbooba leaves jail, detained at home. So former Chief Minister and PDP President Mehbooba Mufti has been shifted from a Srinagar sub-jail to her official residence, which has also been declared as a sub-jail, and she has been put under house arrest. She was arrested on August 5, 2019 as part of the crackdown ahead of the withdrawal of JNK special status. She was booked under Public Safety Act on February 6, 2020 and has been in solitary confinement for more than 8 months now. So now she has been shifted to her own official residence. She will be under house arrest. Her daughter has said in a tweet, opposing a move that seeks to obliterate her identity has been criminalized. So this is preventive detention which took place, that since Jammu and Kashmir special status has been revoked, they would protest and there would be action from the political class. It is the politicians of Jammu and Kashmir. She was a former chief minister. So their opposition has been criminalized. That too, preventing opposition. So she says that you can't wish away the resentment and alienation people feel by criminalizing a debate about illegal abrogation of Article 370. So it has been called illegal. They have a right to express their views and opinions, but that has opportunity has not been given, and they have been jailed. Then next is total invest rupees 3,707 crore in Adani joint venture. So Gujarat-based Adani Green Energy Limited, which is part of the diversified Adani Group, has formed an equal joint venture with French energy giant Total SA. It has invested, Total SA has invested rupees 3,707 crore in the joint venture that includes 2.184 gigawatt of solar projects across 11 states in the country. Earlier also, Total SA and Adani had a deal, and this was they formed a joint venture for gas distribution and retailing of petroleum products in India. Adani Group Green Energy Limited has set an ambitious target of achieving 25 gigawatts of solar power capacity by 2025, and has committed to invest over 70% of its budgeted capital expenditure into clean energy and energy efficient systems in the country. So this is commitment by Gujarat by Adani's one branch, that is Green Energy Limited, Adani Green Energy Limited. Then next is Tata Power Unit bags 300 megawatt deal for 1,730 crores. So Tata Power Solar, which is wholly owned subsidiary of Tata Power, has received approval to build 300 megawatt CPSU-2 for NTPC, which is a central public sector undertaking. So the reverse auction was held, and Tata Power won this bid. So it will be this will this is actually the project is a grid connected solar photovoltaic project, which will be in Alappuzha in Kerala, and will be executed on the reservoir of NTPC. Then next is RBI eases overdraft rules for states. So in order to provide greater flexibility to state governments to tide over their cash flow mismatches due to the lockdown, so Reserve Bank of India, RBI, has decided to increase the number of days for which states or union territory can be in overdraft continuously to 21 working days from the current stipulation of 14 working days. And even in a quarter, overdraft is allowed for 36 working days, but it has now been increased to 50 working days in a quarter. And this arrangement will be valid till September 30, 2020. So what is this overdraft? You should understand. Overdraft basically is a facility wherein a current account holder with the bank gets to withdraw money in excess of the effective credit balance in their current account. It's different from a loan. Loan is a specific amount which has been extended by the bank to an organization or individual for a very specific purpose and has to be repaid over time. So that is it. And the last news is economy to contract 4.5% in fourth quarter, says ICRA, Indian Credit Rating Agency. So the Indian economy is likely to witness a sharp contraction of 4.5% during fourth quarter of financial year 2020. Means it will be minus 4.5% as such reduction. So it will recover also is what has been stated in the financial year 2021. Growth is expected to be just 2%. So this is because of nationwide lockdown imposed in the backdrop of COVID-19 pandemic. You can see GDP growth had already been on its 27 quarter low in the third quarter of financial year 2020 at 4.7%. And now it is said it will have a 4.5% reduction in the last quarter. So that is it. Thank you.